So, hi, Federico. To start with, I would like to ask you to tell me a little bit about yourself and why you're interested in degrowth.
Yes, thank you, Lucia. I am an environmental planner specialized in the study of institutions and politics. So I study how institutions change and therefore how we can build new institutions. In my work, I am focusing on all kind of practices, experiments that try to reduce the ecological impact of urban development on the planet. I look at those practices and try to explain how they indeed produce new institutions that allow those practices to replicate in other places or grow in scale. I am an urban scholar, so I focus specifically on urban environments, city regions. And when I mean urban environments, I also include all kind of rural and natural areas which fall within the city regional territories that I study.
So, on that topic, can you tell us why it's important that the urban and agrarian spaces come into dialogue?
It's very important because economic growth today relies on the separation between urban, rural, and natural areas. When we look at the way urbanization in the planet is developing, we see that there is a highest concentration of people in cities, which are dense urban and built environments. And we see that areas that are rural or non-built become functional to those built environments. This creates an asymmetric or an unbalanced relationship between cities and how they function and rural and natural areas. Just to give you an example, today many rural areas in the world are used, in fact, and abused in order to produce materials such as lithium or coltan, which are used to build infrastructures such as batteries or cables in urban environments. These areas, often far out of the boundaries of city regions, are areas where indeed we see also all kind of exploitation mechanisms and neocolonial mechanisms. So we see that urbanization somehow creates the black side of its own existence into the exploitation of rural areas.
So, what does degrowth invite us to when we talk about these urban and agrarian dynamics?
Degrowth invites us to rethink this asymmetry or this imbalanced division and trying to see things in terms of symbiosis. So the question that degrowth poses is, how can we imagine an urban, rural, natural system that is in symbiosis? So, which means, how can we imagine cities, for example, that also do not only exploit rural areas, but actually regenerate them? How can we imagine rural areas which coexist with urban environments, where they actually create a balanced relationship within them? This opens up all kinds of opportunities for degrowth thinking, opportunities with regards to different ways to produce or produce commodities, naturally, obviously, different ways to produce and distribute food, different ways to manage water systems, also different ways to deal with waste and how to deal with it instead of exporting it or simply landfilling it or incinerating it, but how to deal with it in terms of composting it or reusing it also for other types of manufacture or agriculture itself in case of organic waste. Of course, these are not only spatial and geographical questions, they're also social questions, social political questions. Rebalancing urban and rural and natural environments invites us to think also in terms of social and ecological justice, how we can indeed protect communities that have been for a long time exploited in order to extract materials for urban environments. How can we protect them and produce also and sustain indigenous economies, agricultural economies that are able indeed to survive without being somehow dependent on the demand of materials of ever-expanding city regions? So it is indeed a social ecological question as well. Urban symbiosis occurs at different scales, and so there this dialogue between urban and rural can be practiced in different levels. Of course, we can think in terms of very micro scale, local scale, when we look at urban gardening practices or regional food networks or community-supported agriculture that takes place within densely urbanized city regions. But again, as the example that I mentioned before, we can think in terms of global value chains of food provision or water provision. So I think this has a lot of opportunities for degrowth thinking and a lot of things to discover at the moment, I believe.
What I want to ask you now is regarding these examples of the practices and political changes that need to happen. Can you give us two or three basic points that would need to change to make this a reality?
Yes, it is essential to repeat, degrowth does not happen without a serious downscaling of demands of resources by the countries that, of course, demand the most in this planet. This is essential also to open up spaces to rethink the relationship between urban and rural environment. Said this, we can think about a broad repertoire of possible interventions, courses of actions, regulations, policies that we can enact in order to reestablish this symbiosis between urban and rural environments. The first, very important, is that we need to have a cultural shift in the way we think in terms of, we think about cities and the way we think about our urbanized society. So we need to think in terms of social ecologies, which means indeed to understand cities not only as dense networks of material infrastructures or financialized economies or platform economies, but cities as spaces that actually have a material and biophysical demands in terms of food, in terms of water, but also in terms of health, biodiversity, clean air, and so on and so forth. So in terms of cities seen as ecosystem, this is essential for first step towards this symbiosis that we're talking about. The second thing that we could imagine to change, I would suggest, is to think in terms of how do we regulate institutionally the urban environments and the rural environments. At the moment, we still take a separation between the two. There are regulations which are specifically for the rural areas. There are regulations that are specifically for the urban ones. They often do not interfere with each other, and that's why we have this imbalanced power between the two. Maybe we need to rethink in terms of regulations that deal with the relationship between them, relationships that are visible in terms of clean air quality, water quality, in terms of biodiversity within regional systems, in terms of biodiversity and ecologies within urban areas. These are all examples of intervention that can be indeed rethought, I would say, even in the short term. Of course, we need also to think in terms of social ecological justice, as I said before. So we need to also enact policies, I would say, and interventions that deliberately protect and to a certain extent preserve areas that have been at the moment exploited or overexploited by urbanization. Regulations such as, simple things such as forbidding landfilling or obliging for a degree of composting. These are essential steps, for example, in avoiding that waste produced in cities get dumped in rural areas around them. I think socio-ecological justice is a specific priority in this term. And it goes as far as protecting also areas of exploitations which are far out from urban environments, like the Amazons and the indigenous communities living there, the large-scale soya productions, the large-scale mining that for sand, for example, to build concrete. It's important, in fact, to put those places at the center of a future urban and rural agenda, because those places are essential for the survival of the built environment. But there are also places where there are already existing indigenous culture, there are existing qualities that have to be nurtured. So I think in terms of urban rural environments allow us to broaden the scope of the possible actions that we can undertake.
Thank you. So I want to bring something up. You know, in August, there is the 8th International Degrowth Conference happening. So the main theme of the conference is caring communities for radical change. In that sense, I want to ask you, how does the rural and urban conversation relate to care and radical change?
Very good question. There are different dimensions, I would say, of thinking in terms of care when thinking about urban and rural and natural environment. The first and probably the most immediate is the care of the existing ecological qualities within cities and within rural areas. So the care for the ecology is one, I would say, one step in thinking in terms of care and well-being for radical change. This means protecting and also promoting new environmental and ecological qualities within cities and within overexploited rural areas. That's the first. I would also think in terms of care as a respect of the right to existence of rural and natural areas that today are overexploited for the well-being of and the development of urban environments. This means indeed also enacting policies for the maintenance of those qualities that deliberately contain the expansion of urban areas by developing alternative forms of urban design, I would say, but also deliberately, as I said before, promote indigenous economies within non-urbanized areas. Care is also interpersonal care, and living in a symbiosis is also about knowing and perceiving the ecological dimension of ourselves. So one other way to think in terms of urban-rural symbiosis is to indeed pay attention to the quality of the food and the water and the food habits that we have in cities. Rethink those habits in order to shift from industrialized fast food culture that are mostly available in cities, or even to shift from those food deserts that we see in low density urban environment to a way of urban living that contemplate large availability of high quality food for everybody in cities. Availability that can be also catered with through the actual promotion of urban gardening, and community-supported agriculture, which are not simple spaces of food production, but they are, first of all, spaces where people learn to live in symbiosis with nature and with rural, which is the source of their food, indeed.
That's very nice. So I have two final questions for you. One is, I would like to ask you to paint a digital future. How does it look like, and what challenges do we have? And finally, can you give us some information on how people can get involved in the DIGROW movement, especially thinking about the urban and agrarian dialogue?
Yes, about the DIGROW future, I always try to not give a blueprint. That would be a mistake. It would be another form of rationalistic planning, you know, to give how a future urban and rural environment would look like in a DIGROW society. Actually, what is essential to say is not really how it would look like or how it would be designed, but rather how it would function. And as I said, I think that in order to have a symbiosis between urban and rural, we have to develop an ecological perspective on the urban environment that indeed levels up the imbalances between urban, rural, and natural areas. This is a change in perspective rather than a blueprint plan. But I think doing this already will give us good steps towards a more indeed ecologically regenerative society. How can people join the DIGROW movement? There are many ways to do so. I think there are two words we can use to categorize possible ways. The first is prefiguration, and the second is mobilization. Prefiguration happens through doing things, so practicing things, experimenting with trial and error about real-life solutions that can be implemented. This means join any type of activity that tries to, in fact, bring back the rural in the city, but also tries to regenerate the rural environments after they have been exploited for a long time. These are plenty of activities that can be done, and everybody can join one of these activities. It will be a school of degrowth, I would say. The other way is mobilization, which means to politicize these practices. It means to build a social movement, a social political movement out of those isolated practices. This happens through social movements that become advocates for a different policy making, for different regulations, for different ways to plan cities and deal with rural areas. It is essential, and it demands a different type of attitude, which is not only about doing things, but also in terms of building a dialogue and building an agenda for the future, an agenda that can be adopted at the level of government that can produce, hopefully, regulations and policies in favor of an urban and rural symbiosis. So I would say do things and join movements in a nutshell to summarize.
Yeah, that's very valuable information. Thank you so much, Federico. I have a whole new perspective now. I hope people who will get to listen to this interview will also feel that way.
Thank you. Thank you very much.